Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Good morning. Today we are going to discuss about the turning moment diagram, which is a topic of dynamics of machine. All right. So, what is turning moment diagram? This we already discussed in the previous class. Let's just revise it quickly. Turning moment diagram, and it is also known as crank effort diagram, right? So, what it is nothing but a graphical representation of the turning moment of various positions of the crank when the engine is rotating. So, in a particular cycle of IC engine or any engine's a particular cycle, we observe the crank revolution and plot it against the angle at which it is situated at that moment. Okay, so various positions of crank will give the various values of the torque generated. So we plot the torque against the angle, and hence a diagram obtained for a single cycle is called as turning moment diagram. All right, so it is plotted on the Cartesian coordinates, and in which turning moment is taken on the ordinate, that is y-axis, and crank angle is taken on abscissa, that is x-coordinate. Okay. So this we already discussed in the last class, that there are three types which we need to study. First is for double acting steam engine, second is for four-stroke IC engine, and third is for multi-cylinder engine. And I think we discussed for double acting steam engine in the previous class. We discussed the diagram only. Let's see through this theory also. So this was the diagram. Let me start the annotation. So this was the diagram, and on y-axis the torque is represented, on x-axis the crank angle, that is theta, is represented, right? Fp we already discussed. Fp is the piston effort, right? R is the radius of crank. N was the ratio of length of connecting rod to the radius of crank, right? And theta is the angle turned by the crank. All right. So in this diagram, we discussed that how the turning moment diagram, we get these two positive loops in case of a double acting steam engine, right? And for these two positive loops, because in double acting steam engine we get power stroke in two power strokes in one cycle. All right, that's why we get two positive loops. And we discussed about this T mean, that is the mean torque. We draw a mean line, which is the approximate amount of the torque required to run the vehicle or whichever device that engine is connected to. So above this T mean, if the torque is above the T mean line, that is this portion, then it will tend to increase the velocity of the engine. And when the torque is below the mean line, it will tend to reduce the velocity of the engine. All right. So this we already discussed. Let's read through this paragraph. From the above expression, we see that turning moment diagram is zero when the crank angle theta is zero. That is, at this point, at the point of small a, the torque is zero, right? It is maximum when the crank angle is 90 degree. That is, at this point, at point B, the value of torque is maximum. All right, and then 180 at 180 degree, that value of torque is zero again. So in the half crank revolution, that is from 0 to 180 degree, the value of the torque varies from 0 to maximum to 0 again, and the maximum value of torque is denoted by T max. All right, so this is the variation in the first half of the revolution of the crank. Okay, and in the second half of the revolution of the crank, again it varies from 0 to T max at the point D, and again it comes back to zero at the final 360 degree. All right, so this is what is written in this theory. So again, this is shown by the curve ABC. So first positive loop is denoted by ABC, okay, and second loop is denoted by this second curve CDE. Okay, so we already discussed this. I hope this is clear. So let's go to next slide. Okay, again some theory is written over here. Since the work done of the product and work done, how do we calculate the work done in terms of linear motion? The work done is nothing but force into displacement. Okay, so in case of rotary motion, the work done is nothing but torque multiplied by the angular distance, and that angular distance is calculated in terms of angle turned by the crank, that is theta. Okay, so the product of work done is the turning moment and the angle turned. Therefore, the area of turning moment diagram represents the work done. What this is saying is that this area, which is under the curve, this entire area under the curve represents the work done by the crank. All right. Similarly, over here also, area under this curve represents the work done by the crank. All right. This shaded area represents the work done by the crank. Okay. So in actual practice, the engine is assumed to work against the mean resisting torque, that is this T mean. All right. It is represented by this line AF. The mean torque is represented by this line AF. The height of the ordinate AA represents the mean height of the turning moment diagram. So this line from small a to capital A, this represents the mean torque. Okay, this much is the mean torque. All right. Represents the mean height of the turning moment diagram. Since it is assumed to be the work done by the turning moment per revolution is equal to the work done against the mean resisting torque. All right. Therefore, the area of the rectangle A capital A F E, this area A capital A F E, this rectangular area. Let me show that with the different color. This rectangular area, small a F, small a capital A F E. So this area is the mean work done by the engine. That means this much of work is required for by us. Okay, so this is the constant amount of work which we require. But in actual practice, what is happening? First, the crank is giving this much of work, then it comes to zero, and again it is giving this much of work, and it is again coming to zero. But for our requirement, for working purpose, we require a constant amount of work done. All right, because when we drive a vehicle, we don't want it to be going like a bullock cart, that is sometimes increasing the speed suddenly, then decreasing the speed suddenly, and so on. All right, so what we want is a constant work done. So this is what we require. But in actual practice, how we get it? We get it in the type of loops. Okay, sometimes there is a positive loop, sometimes there is a negative loop. All right, so this is how we get. Now, in order to overcome this, how do we overcome this fluctuation? We will study in the further classes that with the help of flywheel, we are able to convert this fluctuating diagram in terms of this rectangular diagram, that is a regular work done. All right. So this we obtain by the help of a flywheel. Anyways, we will study that in next class of further classes. What does this theory says? When the turning moment diagram is positive, that is when engine torque is more than the mean resisting torque. All right. Shown from point B to C, from point capital B to C, that is this point to this entire C point, that is above the mean line, we are considering it as positive. All right. Similarly, in this case also, from D to E, we are considering it as positive. So during this positive loop, that is above the mean line, the engine will try to accelerate. Okay, the crankshaft accelerates and the work is done by the steam. So above this mean line, what this theory is saying is, above this mean line, when we have the value of torque above T mean, then the engine will try to accelerate, means the speed will tend to increase. Okay. And the work done, what we obtain is, it is done by the steam. Because in thermodynamics, you might have studied that two type of work done by the system, and second is the work done on the system. So work done by the system is taken as positive because we are obtaining some output from the system. So that is positive for us. So what this diagram is saying is, above the T mean line, the steam is working. That is, the steam is working and it is pushing the piston. So since steam is working and it is pushing the piston, so we are obtaining the work. Okay, so it is positive for us. So when we obtain this work, what happens is the crankshaft accelerates. Okay, it speeds keep on increasing. That's what is acceleration is. So crankshaft tends to accelerate and hits. Hence, the speed of vehicle will tend to increase. Okay, it will accelerate. Fine. Similarly, the second point, what the second point says is, when we go from C to D, here we get the work done as negative. That is, this area below the T mean line. So what this says is that during when the torque is obtained below the mean torque, we need to work on the steam. That is, we need to work on the system. From some work input is to be given on the system from our side. So that work, when we do the work on the system, it is considered as negative work. So we have to provide some work to the system. All right. And this is what is represented by these lines under the T mean diagram. All right. So again, they have defined few terms. That T is the torque. This T is the torque on the crankshaft. All right. And this T mean is the mean resisting torque. Okay. And again, the accelerating torque on the rotating parts of the engine will be given by T minus T mean. T will be the value of torque at any given instant. Okay. So if this comes out to be positive, that is T minus T mean, if it is positive, then the engine will accelerate. And in case, for instance, at this point, the value of this T is smaller than the T mean. So this equation will give us a negative value. So when we obtain negative value, that means we are giving input to the system. At that time, the deacceleration will take place. When this value was positive, we were getting positive acceleration. And when this value comes out to be negative, we will get a negative acceleration, that is retardation. When retardation comes, the system will tend to decrease the speed. All right. So this is what is written here. If T minus T mean is positive, the flywheel accelerates. And if T minus T mean is negative, then the flywheel retards. All right. So this we discussed in the last class. We discussed just the diagram. In this class, we discussed about the theory also. All right. So this was the first thing, that is single cylinder double acting steam engine. So what three things you have to read is double acting steam engine, four stroke IC engine, and multi cylinder engine. So this first thing we have discussed. I hope it is clear. Let's go to the second topic, that is the four stroke cycle for IC engine. So this you might have already seen, this diagram you might have already seen in the your BME subject. Okay, so this on y-axis again we have the turning moment, that is the torque, and on x-axis we have the crank angle. Okay, so it is again to complete its entire cycle, it needs to rotate two times. The crank needs to rotate two times. That is, two full rotations have to take place. So one full rotation is still 2 pi, and second full rotation is from 2 pi to 4 pi. All right. So one cycle of IC engine, that is four stroke IC engine, completes in two revolution of a crank. Okay, so I hope you already know this. So in three strokes, that is from 0 to 2 pi, that is one complete revolution, two strokes gets completed, that is first is suction stroke and second is compression stroke. So we already know that we need to give input to the system in terms of work. That is by when we kick start a bike, we need to crank the engine by the help of our leg or by self start. So by cranking that engine, we are giving input to the engine. Okay, so in that input, one complete revolution of the crank takes place and the work is done on the system. That's why see these two loops are negative over here. So you may have a doubt that why there is a positive loop over here when we are giving the input to the system. So the answer to that question is, see, you already know that when the suction takes place, when the piston is at TDC and it starts moving towards the bottom dead center, what happens is the piston gives some displacement, and because of some that displacement, the vacuum is created inside the cylinder, okay, inside that chamber. Since the piston is displaced, the vacuum is created. Now when vacuum is created, there is a negative pressure, and outside the cylinder, because there is atmosphere, there is a positive pressure. So since this pressure difference, the air automatically gets sucked inside the cylinder. So we need to give work for half cycle of the suction stroke, and because of this negative pressure created, the piston automatically starts moving in that direction because of this negative pressure. All right, so we need to give work to the piston only for this half cycle of suction stroke, and second half of the suction stroke, the piston works by itself. That is, the system starts working by itself. So that's why this small positive loop is created in the suction stroke. So I hope this is clear. And again, for compression, in the compression stroke, we compress the gas. Okay, the piston moves upward. That is, in the suction stroke, the charge, that is air fuel mixture, gets inside the cylinder, and now we need to compress it. So the piston moves upward. So to move the piston upward, we need to give some work. All right. Then at the end of compression stroke, there is a spark generated with the help of spark plug, and that compressed gas gets ignited and it expands. So during this expansion, we get this power stroke. Okay. This power stroke is obtained during the expansion of the gas. So when the gas expands, it tends to push the piston downwards. All right. So when it push the piston downward, that is, we are the gas is working on the piston. That is, we are getting work done by the piston. So when the work is done by the system, it is called as positive work. Right. So we get this positive work, and hence we get only one positive loop. Again, those gases which have burned will be converted into exhaust gases, and we will push them out of the cylinder so that new charge can come in. So again, the piston will move from bottom dead center to top dead center. Now, since this is at so much of high pressure, first we need to evacuate the first we need to give the initial push to the piston so that it can push the gases outside through the exhaust valve. All right, so we need to initially give a small push to the piston, and after some time, the piston to complete that stroke, it automatically starts moving upwards. Okay, so again, there is a small positive loop in the exhaust stroke also. So again, it works on the same principle as we saw in the suction. Since there was a negative pressure, the incoming gases started pushing the piston downwards, and we got this positive loop. And again, because of inertia, this piston was moving upwards and there was a high pressure, and the gases were escaping towards the low pressure, that is towards the atmosphere. So this piston along with its inertia starts going in that direction again. All right. So I hope this is clear. So let's read this. Turning moment diagram of four-stroke cycle IC engine. It is shown in the figure. So this is the figure. And we know that it has one working stroke. This is one working stroke, that is this power stroke. All right. After the crank has turned through two revolutions, that is its complete cycle, this suction, compression, working, that is power stroke and exhaust. This is a complete cycle, and this complete cycle takes place in two revolutions of the crank. First revolution is 0 to 360 degree. In that, two strokes takes place, suction and compression, and again it rotates from 360 degree to 720 degree. In those two, in that we get two strokes, that is one is power stroke and one is exhaust stroke. So to complete one cycle, the crank needs to revolve two times, that is two revolutions of the crank are required. That is it will come out to be 720 degree or from 0 to 4 pi. So I hope this is clear. Let's see what theory we need to study for this. Again, since the pressure inside the cylinder is less than the atmospheric pressure during the suction stroke, right? This is what we discussed in the last slide, that there is a negative pressure inside the cylinder. So while suction. So therefore the negative loop is formed as shown in the figure. This negative loop is formed. During the compression stroke, the work is done on the gases. Again, we are working on the gases, so we obtain a negative loop. A higher negative loop is obtained. So as you can see that during the compression stroke, this is value is greater than the amount of work which you provide is greater than that in the suction stroke. All right. So this much is the difference. All right. So in case of compression stroke, gas, we need to do more work. So a higher negative loop is obtained. All right. Now during the expansion or working stroke, the fuel burns and the gases expand. Okay. Therefore, a large positive loop is obtained. So as we discussed in the last slide, that this large positive work, this positive loop is obtained because gases expand and they tend to push the piston downwards. So we obtain this large negative loop, large positive loop. Okay. So in this power stroke, the work is done by the gases. So since the work is done by the system, so we tend to count it as positive. Now, during the exhaust stroke, the work is done on the gases. Again, in order to push the gases outside of the cylinder, we need to do some work on the gases. All right. So since the work is done on the system, therefore a negative loop is formed. This negative loop is formed. And again, due to inertia, it starts going. So we see this a small positive loop. Because of inertia, we don't need to work on that. All right. So last line is, it may be noted that the effect of inertia forces on the piston is taken into account. This small positive loop is the effect of inertia. All right, again here, the small positive loop is the force of is the effect of inertia. So I hope this is clear. Okay, so let's move on to the third topic. That is, we discussed this two things. Double acting steam engine, four stroke IC engine. Now the third topic is multi cylinder engine. All right. So this is the diagram of multi cylinder engine. Since if you are able to understand these two diagrams clearly, you will be able to comprehend this diagram very easily. So a different type of turning moment diagram for a compound steam engine having three cylinders, whose resultant torque diagram is shown in this figure. So there are three cylinders, that is cylinder one, this type of line. See, you can differentiate in the type of lines. This is a solid, sorry. this is a solid blue color line. This is for cylinder one. All right. Then there is this dotted line. This is for cylinder two. And then the third type of line is there is a solid line, there is a small dot, then solid line, then small dot, then solid line, then small dot. This type of line system is called as chain. The chain looks like this. You might have seen this in while studying engineering drawing also. And we saw this in the AutoCAD also. Okay, this is very common in AutoCAD. So you can easily differentiate if you look closely. All right. So there are three cylinders, cylinder one, cylinder two, and cylinder three. And there is a resultant turning moment diagram which is plotted. When you overlap this diagram of three cylinders simultaneously, you will obtain a resultant turning moment diagram something like this. Now, how you will obtain this? So it is written over here. The cranks in the case of three cylinders are usually placed at 120 degree to each other. Now what this means is, let's suppose this is the turning moment diagram of the first cylinder, that is cylinder one. Okay, so from 120 degree to this, 0 to this is 180 degree. So 120 degree would be somewhere over here. All right, so it's the second cylinder's suction stroke will start from here. Okay, sorry, like this. Again, there will be compression stroke, and here it will be the power stroke for the second cylinder. All right, now for the third cylinder, it will start at 120 plus 120, that is at the 240 degree. So here it is 360 degree. And 360 degree, and before 360 degree, it will be over here. All right, let me take another color. This color, okay. So it will start over here. This is 240 degree. So 240 degrees, there will be suction stroke, there will be compression stroke, and there will be power stroke. So this is how we will obtain the total turning moment diagram of three cylinders put together. Okay, so this is what is shown over here. You can see. So the second cylinder starts at its compression stroke from 120 degree, and the third cylinder will start its suction stroke at 240 degree. So this is what is written over here. And the first cylinder is high pressure cylinder, the second cylinder is intermediate cylinder, and the third cylinder is the low pressure cylinder. So I hope this is clear to you. And in the next lecture, we'll be studying about the how this fluctuation of this energy will be, how this fluctuation will be controlled and put to our use. So thank you, everyone. This is it for today.